Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sergio Granados, and on behalf of the Union County Board of Chosen Freeholders, I thank you for coming here today. I'd like to welcome you today to the Union County Medal of Honor recipient ceremony. At this time, Sheriff Ralph Froelich will direct an honor guard and lead us in the flag salute. Please remain standing after the flag salute for our national anthem that will be sung by David Vincent Alston. Sheriff Froelich.
Officer in guard.
Well done. Thank you, Mr. Austin, and thank you, Sheriff. Just so everyone knows, the honor guard is made up of members of the prosecutor's office, the sheriff's office, and the corrections office. The invocation will now be given by Reverend Higgs of the historic First Presbyterian Church of Elizabeth. Reverend Higgs.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we draw our hearts to you. So guide our minds, so fill our imaginations, so control our wills, that we may be wholly yours, utterly dedicated to you. Use us as you will, always to your glory and the welfare of your people. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Higgs. Now it's my pleasure to introduce the Master of Ceremonies, Freeholder Alexander Mirabella. Freeholder Mirabella's accomplishments and contributions are many. They include workforce development, technology improvements in all libraries across the Union County, alcohol and drug prevention, and advocacy for shared services between local, municipal, and county government. He has been a strong and constant supporter of the veterans. Freeholder Mirabella, along with our county manager, Alpha Yellow, have facilitated the establishment of the Medal of Honor memorial we dedicate today. Freeholder Mirabella.
Thank you, Freeholder Granados. Before we move any further, Sheriff Froelich, will you please lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Gentlemen, I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Everybody please be seated. Thank you, Sheriff. And thank you for that introduction, Freeholder Granados. I want to also thank Judge Cassidy for the gracious use of this beautiful courtroom here in Union County for this prestigious celebration. This year, our nation marks the 150th anniversary of the Civil War. The City of Elizabeth celebrates the 350th anniversary. Earlier this year, we celebrated Dr. Martin Luther King's still inspiring I Have a Dream speech delivered on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. Next month, we will mark the 50th anniversary of President Kennedy's assassination. In his inaugural address, President Kennedy spoke these words, "Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, to support any friend, oppose any foe, in order to assure the survival and success of liberty." Today, we humbly pay tribute to 10 Union County heroes who paid the price, some with their lives, who bore the burden, some who met battle and hardship. Their bravery in the face of the most unspeakable horrors of war has given us freedom and liberties that we cherish. Today is a special day for Union County. We are the first county in New Jersey to dedicate a permanent memorial to those heroes who have been awarded our nation and our military's highest medal and highest honor, the Medal of Honor. Going forward, we plan to develop an educational curriculum for students in our public schools to inspire them and to remind them of the extraordinary lives we remember here today. All of us, no matter our age or background, should be profoundly grateful for those who have protected and served us in the past and those in our military who continue to safeguard our nation at home and abroad today. Before we continue, I do want to point out some special people that are in the audience today, some dignitaries from around our county. Besides Freeholder Granados and I, we have two other members of the Freeholder Board. I want to introduce them, and that's Freeholder Bergen and Freeholder Wright. Thank you, Freeholders, for being here. We also have our... Oh, yeah, thank you. I didn't mean to shortchange your applause, Freeholders. We have our county manager, Al Faella, is here. We have Assemblyman Joe Cryan in the back. Assemblyman, thanks for taking time to be there. Also several mayors, Mayor Chris Bowidge, and also Mayor Ellen Dixon. Mayors, thank you for being here. We have the Councilman Sal Mayone from the City of Rahway, great veteran, Sal. Deputy Mayor from Cranford, Ed O'Malley. Deputy Mayor, thank you. Happy to see the First Assistant Prosecutor Eisenhower here. Thank you, First Assistant. And I hope I didn't miss anybody, but thank you for letting me take the honor of introducing my colleagues in public service on an elected basis, and of course joined by Sheriff Froelich and our clerk, Joanne Rajapi, who I'll introduce a little bit later. We have several veterans groups, which I'm delighted took time to be here with us today. The Vietnam Veterans of America Post 779 from Elizabeth. The American Legion Post 35 from Union. The VFW Post 2230 from Kenilworth. The Central Jersey Leathernecks. And the Vietnam Veterans of America Post 688 from Westfield. Thank you all. We also have representatives from the Historical Society of Plainfield, the Summit Historical Society, the Union Historical Society, and the Historical Society from Rahway. We are very happy. Helping us today are 12 cadets from Linden High School ROTC program. I'm glad they're with us. Thank you for being here. Also with us are Mr. and Mrs. Blake Scott, who came here from South Carolina. Mr. Scott is a descendant of Julian Scott, who is among the earliest and youngest recipients of the Medal of Honor for his valor during the Civil War. Thanks for making the journey here. And you brought your dog, too. That was nice. I do have a couple of other special thank yous that I want to just take a minute to share with all of you here assembled. And that is, first of all, with Betty Sebring, who has really pulled this event together, reached out to many of the speakers, and had a genuine and true interest in delivering a top-notch program, which the Medal of Honor winners deserve. So, Betty, thank you for all your help. And my other thank you goes to Lester Sargent, who I think we talked before, about a year ago today, he asked if he could have a couple of minutes before one of the Freeholder meetings to talk to me about something. And of course, knowing Lester over the years, I knew it was going to be a valuable discussion. Little did I know that it was going to turn into this memorial and this honor for our Medal of Honor recipients. But you know, Lester certainly was the inspiration behind this memorial, and when he came to me and we talked about how best we could partner from the county standpoint, working with the veterans to pull this event together and establish this permanent memorial, I was just thrilled to partner and be with him. And Lester, I really want to thank you for all your help. For all your efforts, you got a terrible seat in the corner. I'm sorry for that. Now I would like to get on with the program and what we're all here for. I do have the honor of introducing our County Veteran Services Officer, Richard Thompson, to briefly describe the county services for veterans. Richard?
Thank you, Mr. Marabella. Good afternoon, distinguished guests, county officials, ladies and gentlemen, and veterans of Union County and outside of our county who are here. I'm going to briefly tell you some facts about the County of Union's Veterans Affairs Office and the honor that I have had as the county service officer for the last 12 years. It has been said that each of us has a destiny in life. My destiny took a sharp right turn in 2001, right after the tragedy of 9/11. When I started helping thousands of veterans who called the County Veterans Service Office for assistance about their benefits, about their needs, and actually how they could join the military to help our country in a time of need. All of our direction for this office comes from a simple statement in Abraham Lincoln's second inaugural address: to care for him who shall have borne the battle, his widow, his orphan. From this statement, all veteran benefits evolved. Healthcare, the New Jersey healthcare system, one of the largest in the world. Compensation benefits for soldiers and veterans who received injuries, residuals of injuries. Pensions that veterans can receive. Education benefits that far exceed anybody's imagination today from the very beginning. It is really something to see what they get today. And burial benefits in the most active military cemetery, state cemetery in the country, Major William General Doyle Cemetery in South Jersey. And by the way, this cemetery received this year a $10,700,000 grant from the federal government for future improvements for dignified burials. Our outreach has included job fairs, two of which this county office has done with Betty and several of us in the last year. This office works regularly with the New Jersey VA healthcare system, and in particular, mental health. And just before I came here, I had a phone call from a young 22-year-old Afghan veteran in dire needs for mental health care. We furnish transportation assistance from the Union County Paratransit for medical appointments, for stand-downs, and needy homeless veterans events. These services are available for all of our 20,000-plus men veterans, our 3,000-plus women veterans in Union County. Unfortunately, they're dying off at a fast rate. The office participates in state medal ceremonies, such as the New Jersey Distinguished Service Medal awarded to veterans. Today's very distinguished program for our 10 Medal of Honor recipients is the result of our outreach to the American Legion Service Organization. In closing, I'd just like to say, a veteran is a soldier, whether on active duty or discharged, retired or reservist, who at one point in his life wrote a blank check payable to the United States of America for an amount up to and including his life. Earlier I said that each of us has a destiny in life. For these 10 men, the Medal of Honor is the United States of America's highest military honor awarded for personal acts of valor above and beyond the call of duty. The medal is awarded by the President of the United States in the name of Congress to U.S. military personnel only. There are three versions of this medal, one for the Army, which we have here today, one for the Navy, one for the Air Force. Personnel from the Marine Corps and the Coast Guard received the Navy version of the Medal of Honor. It was conceived in the early 1860s and first presented in 1863. There are 3,463 total recipients of the Medal of Honor. Today, there are only 79 living Medal of Honor recipients. New Jersey is credited with 94 recipients. This memorial site was created to pay tribute to these 10 men from Union County whose outstanding bravery in the face of mortal danger earned them the Medal of Honor for the highest medal in the country for conspicuous gallantry, intrepidity that you can receive. Thank you for your service. Let freedom ring. God bless America.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson, for those words and also for your work throughout the year on behalf of our veterans here in Union County. At this point in our program, we will hear about each of Union County's Medal of Honor recipients, but before we do that, I do want to say a special thank you to Dennis Daugherty, who brought the actual Medal of Honor here that is housed at the National Guard Armory in Westfield. And Dennis, thank you for doing that. And after the program, I'm sure Dennis will share some comments about the Medal of Honor and its journey here. And I appreciate you being here and doing that, Dennis. Thank you. Now I'm pleased to introduce the speakers who will present the Medal of Honor recipients from the Civil War, the Indian campaigns, and World War I. And in sequence, they are Joanne Rajapi, County Clerk and Chair of the County Civil War Sequicentennial. I'm glad I was able to pronounce that. I worried about that last night. I'm not even sure I pronounced it right. Commemoration Committee. And congratulations to you, Joanne, on your new book. It's the story of her great-grandfather and 18 of his friends and colleagues who went to fight in the Civil War. Her book is titled New Brunswick and the Civil War, The Brunswick Boys and the Great Rebellion. I look forward to reading that, Joanne. Following Joanne is Captain James Russo from the Prosecutor's Office. Captain Russo is an Army combat veteran of Operation Iraqi Freedom. And Walter Hill, a former Marine and Vietnam combat veteran who returned to active duty in Iraq in 2008 and Afghanistan in 2012 after retiring from the military in 1996. Mr. Hill was invited to speak about the only Marine among our 10 Medal of Honor recipients. It was this Marine, Fred W. Stockham, who was the basis for the memorial project. The American Legion, Post 35 from Union, asked Mr. Thompson if the county had a picture of Mr. Stockham that was hung in the courthouse. Mr. Thompson checked with Lester Sargent, who had worked in the sheriff's office for many years. The photograph was located out of state, but this inquiry piqued Lester's interest and curiosity, and the historical search began. Lester discussed this research with Vincent Distrolio, our undersheriff who's in the audience, his former colleague in the sheriff's office, and the project was presented to me last January as I talked a little bit earlier. In keeping with all the historical celebrations this year, we were able to work around other events and hold this dedication today before the end of the year, which was important for us. Now let's hear more about our Medal of Honor recipients. I'd like to introduce our County Clerk, Joanne Rajapi.
Good afternoon, everyone. Judge Cassidy, Freeholder Mirabella, elected officials, honored veterans, and friends. It's an honor today for me to present the 5 Civil War Medal of Honor winners. Some of you that came in the courthouse today may be aware that there is a Civil War exhibit in our rotunda. And that exhibit has been put together by the Civil War Sesquicentennial Committee. You did a good job with that, Al. It's a hard word. And actually, 2 weeks from today, we will be honoring those 5 Civil War recipients right here in Judge Cassidy's courtroom. So we hope you'll come back for that, program. You may be surprised to know that 3 of the Civil War honorees today knew each other and were friends. Their service and commitment to preserving the Union certainly lives long after their deaths and is a commemoration to their wonderful dedication to the country. So please join me in hearing a little bit about their background and service. First, James Madison Drake, 2nd Lieutenant Company D, 9th New Jersey Infantry, U.S. Army, also breveted Brigadier General by a special act of the New Jersey Legislature. By recommendation of General Ulysses S. Grant, James Madison Drake was presented with the Medal of Honor issued March 3, 1873, for extraordinary heroism on the 6th of May, 1864, at Bermuda Hundred in Virginia. His citation notes that throughout the day, he, quote, commanded the skirmish line in advance of the Union troops and held his position all day and during the night, end of quote. In 1861, Drake organized the first company of volunteers raised in New Jersey and declined to be its captain. After serving 3 months, he reenlisted with 9th New Jersey Volunteers and remained with this regiment until the war's end in 1865. He was promoted through the ranks to captain. When the Army of the Potomac crossed into Virginia in March 1861, Drake unfurled the first flag on Confederate soil. He was taken prisoner in May 1864 when Company D, 9th New Jersey Infantry, was surrounded by Confederate soldiers. He, along with three other officers, jumped from a fast-moving train that was moving 600 prisoners from Charleston to Columbia, South Carolina. Drake and his comrades made their way through three Confederate states and 1,000 miles later returned safely to Union lines in Tennessee. According to his obituary published in the New York Times in November 1913, Drake died in his home at 1116 Jefferson Avenue here in Elizabeth. He was the publisher of the Elizabeth Daily Monitor, the Elizabeth Sunday Leader, the Elizabeth Daily Leader. He authored Fast and Loose in Dixie, Across the Continent in Red Breeches, Historical Sketches of the Revolutionary and Civil Wars, and New Jersey in the War for the Union. Drake is a direct descendant of Nathaniel Drake of Plainfield. During the Revolutionary War, General George Washington strategized with his officers in the Drake House during the Battle of Short Hills in 1777. Today, the Drake House, located on West Front Street, is home to the Historical Society of Plainfield. In 1901, the Union County Board of Chosen Freeholders made Drake the supervisor of soldiers' monuments. His recommendation to mark soldiers' graves is carried on today by Union County Office of Veterans Services. Flags are placed on each grave annually for Memorial Day. James Madison Drake is buried in Evergreen Cemetery in Hillside. Medal of Honor issued March 3, 1873, for extraordinary heroism while serving with Company D, 9th New Jersey Infantry, in action at Bermuda 100 in Virginia. Julian A. Scott, drummer, Company E, 3rd Vermont Infantry, United States Army. At the age of 15, in June 1861, Julian Scott lied about his age and enlisted in the 3rd Vermont Infantry, Company E. Physically too small to be a soldier, he became a drummer. Soon after enlisting, he experienced a bloody battle in what was the Union's first major offensive to capture Richmond, Virginia, capital of the Confederacy. The attack failed, and on April 16, 1862, during the Battle of Lee's Mills, Union forces were ordered to withdraw. Under enemy fire, Julian Scott repeatedly crossed a bloody stream to rescue at least 9 wounded soldiers. In February of 1865, Scott received the Medal of Honor for heroism in battle. He was 16 years old at the time. At the end of the war, Scott enrolled in the National Academy of Design in New York City and continued to study art until 1868 under Emanuel Lutz, a German-American artist. Lutz, by the way, is known for his famous 1851 painting of Washington crossing the Delaware, which hangs today in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. Drawing on his experience during the war, and like Lutz, painting in great detail, Scott became one of the preeminent Civil War artists of the 19th century. Many of his works realistically depict the life of a Civil War soldier, while others are large battle scenes. One of Scott's most famous works is at the Drake House Museum, is The Death of General Sedgwick. Scott is also known for his paintings of Native American Indians, done during his participation in the nation's 11th census. In 1870, Scott married Mary E. Burns, whose father owned the New York Post. In 1875, Scott, his wife, and his daughter, Bessie, moved from New York City to Plainfield, where he established an art studio and gallery on West Front Street. He died in Plainfield's Muhlenberg Hospital on July 4, 1901, and is buried at Hillside Cemetery in Scotch Plains. Medal of Honor issued February 1865 for actions at the Battle of Lee's Mill, Virginia. Rufus King Jr., First Lieutenant, 4th U.S. Artillery Regiment, United States Army. Throughout the Civil War, Rufus King Jr. served in the Army of the Potomac, the major Union army in the Eastern Theater. King was awarded the Medal of Honor for heroism at White Oak Swamp Bridge in Virginia. His citation reads, quote, "This officer, when his captain was wounded, succeeded to the command of two batteries while engaged against a superior force of the enemy and fought his guns most gallantly until compelled to retire," end of quote. Of this battle, King later wrote, quote, "After 3 days of constant fighting, we reached White Oak Swamp and there had a narrow escape from capture. Our battery was made the object of attack by 30 pieces of artillery, concentrated by the enemy in an effort to dislodge us from our position. The fire from the guns was frightful, and there was not a portion of the battery that did not get its share of it. We remained in position from 9 a.m. until 2 a.m. the next day, under constant fire all the time, losing a great many men and horses from the fire of the enemy, but succeeded in preventing them from building the bridge and crossing the swamp before our army had reached a place of safety," end of quote. King was the son of Rufus King, who graduated 4th in his class from the United States Military Academy at West Point and was a brigadier general during the Civil War. He was the great-grandson of Rufus King, a signer of the U.S. Constitution, and a candidate for President of the United States. Today, there are numerous accomplished descendants of Rufus King. A few famous ones include Fleet Admiral William Halsey Jr., who commanded the U.S. Third Fleet in the Pacific during World War II. Halsey, by the way, was present when Japan formally surrendered on the deck of his flagship, the USS Missouri. He's also another present-day King descendant is Halsey Minor, who developed CNET, one of Network Internet's first profitable companies. After the war, Rufus King Jr. married Maria Williamson, and they lived in Elizabeth. He is buried in Evergreen Cemetery in Hillside. Medal of Honor issued April 2, 1898, for action against Confederate forces at White Oak Swamp, Virginia, on June 3, 1862. William Brandt, Jr., United States Army, 1st Lieutenant, Company B, 1st New Jersey Veterans Battalion, Breveted Captain, April 2, 1865. William Brandt, Jr. was born in Elizabeth, and he served the entire length of the Civil War. His unit fought in the final assaults on Confederate positions at Petersburg, Virginia, where he captured the battle flag of the 46th North Carolina Infantry. From his actions in this battle, William Brandt was awarded the Medal of Honor on May 10, 1865. Captain Brandt was believed to have been present at General Robert E. Lee's surrender at Appomattox Courthouse on April 9, 1865. After his discharge from the Army, he returned to his hometown of Elizabeth and eventually became a lieutenant in the Elizabeth Police Department, from which he retired. Captain Brandt died March 1, 1898, and is buried in the Brandt family plot at Evergreen Cemetery in Hillside. Medal of Honor issued May 10, 1865, for actions during the Civil War. John Williams II, Boatswain's Mate, U.S. Navy. John Williams II was born in Elizabethtown and entered the Navy from New York. He made the Navy his career. His Medal of Honor citation issued July 10, 1863 states, quote, "Captain of an 18-inch gun aboard the USS Mohican during action of the maid squadron of ships against the heavily defended forts Beauregard and Walker on Hilton Head, South Carolina, and against the ships of the Confederate fleet, the 7th of November, 1861. Cool and courageous at his battle station, Williams maintained steady fire against the enemy while under the fort batteries during a four-hour engagement, which resulted in silencing the batteries of the forts and in the rout of the rebel steamers, end of quote. This November 1861 battle, the Battle of Port Royal, was one of the earliest amphibious operations in the Civil War. Throughout the summer of 1861, the U.S. Navy's Atlantic Blocking Squadrons was assigned the mission of blockading the entire Atlantic coast of the Confederacy. Land forces, namely the U.S. Army, were needed to gain possession of shore facilities. To aid in the blockade of Charleston, combined northern forces of the U.S. Naval Fleet and the U.S. Army captured Port Royal Sound, South Carolina, between Savannah, Georgia, and Charleston, South Carolina. Two forts, Fort Walker on Hilton Head Island and Fort Beauregard on Phillips Island, guarded the Sound's entrance. The Mohican was one of the ships that inflicted great damage on Fort Walker. When firing ceased, the Confederate commander at Phillips Island, fearing being trapped, ordered his troops to abandon their positions, leaving the fort unmanned. The following morning, the Union flag was raised on Fort Beauregard, and Union forces occupied the fort. General Robert E. Lee, who was placed in command too late to impact this battle, chose not to attack the Union gunboats. Instead, Lee withdrew his forces from the coast to defend vital interior Confederate positions. John Williams' burial site is unknown. Medal of Honor issued the 10th of July, 1863, for courage shown against ships of the Confederate fleet during the Battle of Port Royal Sound, South Carolina. And that concludes the Medal of Honor winners from the Civil War. It's now my pleasure to introduce Captain James Russo of the Union County Prosecutor's Office, who will present the Medal of Honor recipients for the Indian campaigns. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Theodore F. Smith. Born Theodore Schmidt, born on September 6, 1852, and died June 6, 1925. Private, the United States Army, Company G, 1st U.S. Cavalry, Indian War Campaigns. Theodore Smith was born in Rahway, New Jersey, and received the Medal of Honor for his bravery in battle on October 20th of 1869 at the Chiricahua Mountains in Arizona. This battle was the biggest of the Indian conflicts in that 32 medals of honors were awarded from this one battle, all against the Apache Indians in Arizona. Smith's Company G, 1st Cavalry, was the second most decorated in the Indian campaigns, earning 18 medals. The Indian Wars were a series of conflicts between Native American Indian tribes and European colonial settlers in North America and later the U.S. government. These conflicts forced Native Americans further and further west until the Indians died or were forced to live on reservations. The Chiricahua, which means Great Mountain Group of Apache Native Americans, lived in the southwest United States. They were led by famous Indian chiefs, Cochise, and then Geronimo. Today, the Chiricahua Apache are located in Oklahoma and on a reservation in New Mexico. Theodore F. Smith became a house painter after the war. He died on June 6, 1925 at the Old Soldiers Home in Washington, D.C. He is buried now at Arlington Cemetery. Moving on to World War I. Thomas E. O'Shea, born April 18, 1895, and died on September 29, 1918. Thomas Edward O'Shea was born in New York City. He entered the Army from Summit, New Jersey, and joined the 1st Platoon of the 107th Machine Gun Company, known as the Summit Gunners. This was because of many men in the company were from Summit, New Jersey area. On his draft registration card, O'Shea listed 357 South Broad Street, Elizabeth, as his address. His occupation was listed as a civil engineer with the Central Railroad of New Jersey. Corporal O'Shea, along with John C. Latham and Alan Lewis Eggers, received the Medal of Honor for heroic actions in combat near Le Cité, France on September 29, 1918. O'Shea, along with Latham and Eggers, were separated from their platoon by heavy smoke and took cover in a shell hole well within enemy lines. Hearing a call from a disabled American tank, the three soldiers left their shelter and headed toward a tank under heavy German machine gun fire and trench mortars. Corporal O'Shea was mortally wounded in his actions and posthumously awarded the Medal of Honor on December 31, 1919. It was General John J. Blackjack Pershing who recommended Latham, O'Shea, and Eger for the Medal of Honor. According to a 1919 newspaper report, Corporal O'Shea was the son of Mr. and Mrs. Thomas O'Shea of Summit, New Jersey, and New York City. It was Corporal O'Shea's friend and fellow soldier, Alan Lewis Eggers, who wrote to Mr. and Mrs. O'Shea about the battle that took their son's life. It was the second battle of the Somme that pushed back the German army offensive and ultimately resulted in bringing World War I to an end. The 107th Infantry suffered the largest number of single-day casualties of any regiment in the U.S. Army in that conflict. Corporal O'Shea is buried in Somme American Cemetery and Memorial in Picardy, France. Alan Lewis Eggers, November 2, 1895, October 3, 1968. Sergeant, United States Army, Machine Gunner, 107th Infantry, 27th Division. Following the 1917 graduation from Cornell University, Alan Lewis Eggers enlisted in the Army from Summit, New Jersey. He joined the 1st Platoon of the 107th Machine Gun Company, known as the Summit Gunners. World War I was already raging in Europe when the United States joined the European Allies on April 6, 1917. In 1918, Sergeant Eggers' unit was sent to the battlegrounds of northern France. He, along with John C. Latham and Thomas O'Shea, received the Medal of Honor for heroic actions in combat on September 29, 1918. In addition to the Medal of Honor, Alan Lewis Eggers was awarded the Distinguished Service Cross and Purple Heart. After his military service, Alan Lewis Eggers worked for the New York Stock Exchange and New York and Philadelphia brokerage firm. He died in Princeton at the age of 72 and is buried in Arlington National Cemetery, Washington, D.C. This time I'd like to introduce Walter Hill.
Gunnery Sergeant Frederick Stockham, United States Marine Corps. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm a retired Sergeant First Class, Walter J. Hill. Some might ask why a retired sergeant from the Army is introducing you to Gunnery Sergeant Stockham. I first began my military career in 1971 with the United States Marine Corps. Like many sitting here, I ended up in Parris Island, someplace we don't forget. I ended my career in 2011 with the 10th Mountain Infantry Division in Kandahar, Afghanistan. The Congressional Medal of Honor was awarded to Gunnery Sergeant Stockham on 21 December 1938. His award is held or was held by the Smithsonian Institute because his next of kin could not be located. The award citation tells us why this man was awarded the CMH. But it doesn't tell us about the man, and very little is known about Gunnery Sergeant Stockham. The organization of the Marine Infantry Company during World War I authorized one gunnery sergeant per company. He was the trainer, he was the mentor, he was the subject matter expert in all things infantry. He knew tactics, weapons, customs, courtesy, military bearing. He was the man. He proceeded probably from day one to impose his will on the 96th Company. He was not probably hesitant in placing a well-aimed polished boot on the fifth point of contact of a Marine Corps private that happened to make a mistake when he was in the neighborhood. By doing so, he established himself as the man, as the guy that is there to make them as a single entity, that they would move as a single unit and not 189 different individuals. He was the man that made them. He imposed his will on the 96th Company. The 96th Company became Gunnery Sergeant Stockham. During the Battle of Belleau Woods, the Germans broke through the French lines and threatened a major supply line behind the Allied lines. Had they accomplished that, the outcome of World War I may have been a whole different situation. The Marines moved overnight by force march, and the 96th Company was part of that. They assumed positions in Belleau Woods and repelled numerous attacks by the Germans using bayonets and rifles. The Germans figured out that they couldn't push the Marines, soon to be named and better known as devil dogs by the Germans. They weren't going to move them out. They brought up the artillery and mixed with the HE, where high explosive rounds was mustard gas. During that battle in June of 1918, Sergeant Stockham saw a young Marine probably suffering from the effects of mustard gas, not able to use his own gas mask, removed his gas mask, signing his own death warrant, and put it on the young Marine. Sergeant Stockham succumbed to the mustard gas effects a few days later. Sergeant Stockham's actions demonstrate the pride and premier, I forgot the word, premier attitude of an American combat sergeant. Sergeant Stockham is a tribute to the American fighting force that God created to protect a free people. Sergeant Stockham is buried in Hollywood Cemetery in Union. Thank you.
It's my honor also now to introduce our guest speaker and great family friend, Dr. Ralph Orsello. Dr. Orsello has a special connection to Union County. His dad, also named Ralph, was our former sheriff. And Dr. Orsello is chief of cardiology, is chief cardiology division at the East Orange Veterans Administration Medical Center. He is also associate professor of the medicine of at Rutgers New Jersey Medical School. And over the years, Dr. Orsello was honored for his outstanding scholarship and his teaching skills. His many contributions and achievements are most impressive. He honors us today by sharing his knowledge of Major Charles Joseph Waters, an Army chaplain who he encountered from his service in Vietnam. Dr. Orsello volunteered for duty in Vietnam, where he served as chief of staff at the 93rd Evacuation Hospital in Long Binh. He was awarded the Bronze Star, the Meritorious Service Medal, the Army Commendation Medal with Oak Leaf Cluster, and received many unit citations. During Operation Desert Storm, Colonel Orsello served as Chief of Critical Care Medicine at Walter Reed Army Medical Center. It's my high honor now to introduce Dr. Ralph Orsello.
I want you to picture this. When Chaplain Waters would kneel next to a wounded warfighter, when he would begin to pray for his survival, and when indicated for the repose of his soul, whether in an Army hospital were on the battlefield, he would utter the words of the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The wounded trooper was told that he would be cared for by his God as a good shepherd would care for his flock. Though the wounded, dying warfighter on the battlefield was without question in the valley of the shadow of death, the good chaplain hoped that fear would be alleviated knowing the Lord was with him. His enemies would no longer hurt him. God was waiting to receive him in his house where he would dwell forever. Performing this sacred ritual takes time. He would do it over and over again, no matter how much time it took, with total disregard for his own safety. He knew without question what could happen to him as a result of his selfless behavior, and yet he feared not. In order to maintain a license to practice medicine in New Jersey, one must document that he or she has successfully completed a course in cultural awareness. The patient population at the VA Medical Center makes this necessary. There is also cultural diversity in the medical students, residents, and fellows. There are more women than men. Asian students are in the majority. As individuals and as a group, they are brilliant. The doctors-to-be are graduates of the finest medical schools. They can and will excel in all areas of medicine except one, military medicine. Few, if any, will volunteer for military duty. That is why they have to take my course in military cultural awareness. They are told that upon meeting a patient, after a proper introduction, they will ask the veteran three questions. Number one, what branch of the armed services did you serve in? Number two, when and where did you serve? And number three, what was your military occupational specialty? The lessons learned cannot be found in medical or history texts. They learn importantly that the VA facility is not a private hospital where the first question asked by a physician without an introduction is, what health insurance plan do you have? The young people are simply overwhelmed by what they hear. During my 10 years at the VA Medical Center, I have learned that frequently the patients who speak the most about their exploits during the war have done the least. Their major achievements was to have survived. I have found, as have others, that those who remain quiet may have performed heroically during combat, assuring a mission success and saving the lives of their fellow warfighters at the same time. The war dead are a group that cannot be forgotten. They cannot speak for themselves. Their good and heroic deeds, if not witnessed, die and are buried with them. The evil that men do long time lives after them. The good is often interred with their bones, William Shakespeare and Julius Caesar. My intent is to give you some insight into the making of a particular New Jersey hero and Medal of Honor recipient. Someday more heroes will be recognized as there is no statute of limitations on awarding a Medal of Honor from any conflict where the good have prevailed. A hero to be celebrated for as long as there is a United States of America is the former curate at St. Michael's Roman Catholic Church in Cranford. One rarely has a way of knowing who is or was a hero and what they did. The reason Chaplain Waters earned his Medal of Honor will soon become apparent. Most unfortunately, as with more than 60% of the Medal of Honor recipients, Father Charles Waters' Medal of Honor was posthumously presented to his family. In November 1967, one of the major battles of the war was shaping up in the Central Highlands, in the region of Dak To. Several hardened elite North Vietnamese divisions came in major contact with members of the 173rd Airborne Brigade. They were vastly outnumbered. While Dak To was heavily defended by the airborne troops, it was inaccessible by other American forces by land. It had to be supplied by air. Troops rotating in and out, supplies, food, and ammunition brought in by helicopter because of its encirclement by dense forest and unsafe ground routes. As the battle ensued, there was no escape. Unless you were well dug in, there was nowhere to hide. If medical help was needed in Vietnam, unlike World War II or Korea, hospitals did not follow the advancing army in direct support of tactical operations. All army hospitals in Vietnam were fixed installations with area support missions. Since there was no secure road network in this combat area, surface evacuation of wounded was impossible. On this unholy ground, with the 173rd Airborne Brigade, was a 40-year-old Catholic chaplain, Major Charles J. Waters, Born in Jersey City, he had attended Seton Hall Prep and Seton Hall University. His religious studies culminated in his ordination in 1953. His first military exposure in the Army National Guard made him want to be more than just a National Guard physician at that time. He wanted to be all that he could be as a soldier. He earned his airborne wings. His strong religious beliefs and insuppressible spirit led to his volunteering for duty in Vietnam. His first tour was in 1966. During that time in country, he demonstrated his medal, earning a Bronze Star Medal with V for Valor device, as well as an Air Medal. In July 1967, he extended his tour for 6 more months. On the evening of 19 November 1967, word was received that massive numbers of casualties were en route by air to our hospital, the 93rd Evacuation Hospital. Waves of dust-off helicopters, air ambulances landed, unloaded the dead, the dying, and those who would be saved. They refueled and headed back to Dock Tow. One of the first casualties dead on arrival was being given mouth-to-mouth resuscitation by a medic. I told him he could stand down. Failure was preordained. The trooper had a massive chest wound that deprived him of his heart. But men do strange things under stress. Shortly thereafter, the same medic came back with another dead trooper, again giving mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Again, this young man was dead before he was placed on the chopper. On the ground, our troops were being pummeled. Close artillery support was called in. Our men were fighting well within the kill zone of our artillery, exploding 105 and 155 howitzer shells. The enemy was relentless, trying to break through the barbed wire defensive perimeter. The airborne troops never faltered, but being overrun was a real possibility. Bombing runs were now called for. While recognizing that there was danger to the American troops as well as the enemy, the mission was to kill the enemy and not the friendlies. As the battle raged, Chaplain Waters, with complete disregard for his personal safety, rushed ahead to the forward edge of the battle area. He was unarmed and completely exposed, giving aid, encouragement, and when called for, the last rites. For those who have never witnessed a ground battle, an artillery barrage, or the effects of a B-52 bombing raid, it is not hard to understand how men, after an overwhelming adrenaline surge needed to fight or take flight, can stand up, wandering dazed and disoriented in the middle of the battlefield after the adrenaline withdrawal, waiting to die. They become living targets. These physiologic, psychological casualties are watched by their colleagues until they are killed. With others attempting to restrain him, Father Waters ran onto the battlefield. He dragged dead and dying soldiers to relative safety. He literally picked up the psychological casualties and carried them to safety. It must be remembered that moving in front of a line of fire exposes one to both enemy and friendly fire. Ignoring continued attempts to restrain him, Father Waters entered the death arena again and again. Finally satisfied that his men were relatively safe, the good chaplain was giving aid and answering to the needs of his men when he was mortally wounded by the blast of a friendly 500-pound bomb. He had brought with him to the battlefield unyielding perseverance and selfless devotion. On Sunday, 6 October, in the New York Times, there appeared the obituary of Sergeant Nicholas Oresco, United States Army, born and raised in Bayonne, who at 96 years of age at the time of his death was the oldest living American Medal of Honor recipient. His actions at the Battle of the Bulge, taking a hill alone when his men hesitated in following him, were heroic actions that lead to movies being made. The Times quoted him as saying at the time of his action, quote, "I looked up to heaven and I said, Lord, I know I am going to die. Make it fast, please." He did not die, but Father Waters did. Both knew a coward dies 1,000 times before his death, but the valiant taste of death but once. Again, William Shakespeare and Julius Caesar. Chaplain Waters was awarded our nation's highest award for valor, the Medal of Honor. He was one of nearly 3,500 recipients since its inception. It is to be noted again that more than 60% are posthumously awarded. For his conspicuous gallantry and intrepidity at the risk of his own life above and beyond the call of duty, Father Waters became a member of the pantheon of recognized American heroes. Though his actions occurred in the valley of the shadow of death, Father Waters never feared because his God was with him. The world is only improved and lives are saved and enriched by men like Father Waters. Everybody knows that while you can train men to follow orders, while you can teach them that the military success comes with teamwork, while you can teach them to march, shoot, and be an army of one, you do not train them to give up their lives for a fellow American. War fighters are told that they are extremely valuable assets who should not be lost along with those already dead or wounded. War fighters do not plan to do heroic deeds, but they do them time and time again. It is a God-driven reflex. It is what every well-trained, well-equipped, well-left fighter hopes he will be able to do if and when the time comes, when he can save the life of a colleague with little regard for his personal safety. I keep reminding myself that Father Waters' heroism was conspicuous, as was that of every Medal of Honor recipient. But among the 58,000 who died in Vietnam, including the 16,592 who died during my tour, there were more heroes unrecognized. When all die in a great battle, there is no one left to record such heroic deeds. Therefore, while it is appropriate that we honor our New Jersey Medal of Honor awardees, Father Waters would have wanted our prayers and thanks to be shared with all of the war dead, there being more heroes among them than we shall ever know. We are fortunate to be here today. For that, we thank our troops, and we thank God, and we can only hope that he will continue to bless us and the United States of America. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Orsello, for your efforts in and out of the military. I'm proud to know you. We'll close our program with another song by David Vincent Alston, and I'm always happy that I hear the second verse of the Star Spangled Banner. I heard it once before you sing it, and it's always I'm always delighted to hear that second verse. I know there's probably more verses than that, but I think that was wonderful to hear that second verse. Following that, Chaplain Tom Malik Jones from the East Orange Veterans Administration Medical Center will offer the benediction. David?
please join me in a spirit of reverence. Gracious God of glory, sorrow, and hope, you called these warriors to serve their neighbors. And when the warriors faced what our nation called the enemy, Chaplain Waters turned to face the warrior. It is we who are honored and blessed when we identify their love of neighbor and therefore their love of us. Bless this gathering and its enduring witness. May all here identify what we are loyal to. May we embrace the God-blessed mission that makes each of us a healer. May we serve our God, country, neighbor, and spirit, that we may keep that promise that in a long ago generation that Lincoln made on behalf of the nation, that with malice toward none and charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right, let us strive to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, his widow and his orphan, to do all we can to achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Amen.
In conclusion, I would like to thank our speakers, our guests here today, but most importantly, I thank each of you for your dedicated service to our country and making this the greatest country on earth. Thank you. There's a Civil War exhibit upstairs. Please visit. Also, please enjoy the refreshments we have outside and visit the Medal of Honor Memorial on your way out. Follow the bagpipes. Thank you. Have a great day.